Developing Our Math Minds is a series of conversations and resources about math that is intended to be a journey of growth for families over several weeks. Each week, Minds lead mathematician and product director Brandon Smith and content development manager Nina Wu will be talking about the adjustments families are making to learning at home and the opportunities this situation provides for changing our relationship with math.
So as we keep going through these weeks, talking about ways that we can help families in school with homework, extracurricular activities, I think something that is really in the forefront right now that we haven't yet talked about is language. I think our parents are noticing even more how wordy math is. And so I thought it'd be worth a conversation about the use of language. Do textbooks really have to be that dense? And do exams basically have to be paragraphs and novels?
Yeah. So when I started out teaching in my math classes, I was like really excited to teach math because I have a background in it. And so I was like, I can totally teach kids about numbers and math. But then when I entered the classroom and I saw the assessments and the textbooks and the, you know, just like all the worksheets on the materials I was given, I was like, oh, this is like more of a reading test than a math test. And it's actually where my students were really hung up. Like they could calculate fine, like they understood like the mechanics and algorithms of numbers, but then when it came for the practice of it and like on the assessment of it, their performance wasn't reflecting their actual understanding. And I was like, what's happening here? And I realized there was like a huge comprehension problem in the language of it. So they would read these word problems and somehow along the way they were kind of taught to code keywords with different operations. And this was fourth grade, so we're still doing like addition, subtraction, multiplication, division. So it's pretty basic. There's this very like popular poster that some teachers will use where it's like, for addition, here are the keywords, like total or sum. There are these keywords. And I realized I was throwing them off, and I did this activity that was like four corners. So each corner in the room was a different operation. And we would just read a problem together, and I'd be like, go to the corner for the operation that you think you would perform to solve this problem. Don't even solve the problem, but what operation would you use? The word each was in this word problem. I like pulled it from an assessment. And the class was pretty split, multiplication and division. And I was like, okay, now talk amongst yourselves why. And they both came up with the same reasons. Like, the word each is in it. And then
like,
that's
they were gaming
it. Yeah. And the thing is, like, I can design a word problem that says, like, how many in all. That's a subtraction problem or a multiplication problem or a division problem. The language isn't it. And I think what my students didn't realize and what I ended up showing them was that operations are these actions that kind of tell their own stories. Like multiplication has an action with it, and actions happen in stories. So I had them act it out. And like, that's why I'm such a big fan of acting out word problems. It's like, what action are you performing? And that tells you the operation you're performing.
That makes sense. It sounds to me like a simple way to kind of digest that is, we can't hide math behind a layer of language. What happens in practice is we replace mathematical thinking with superficial comprehension. And I wait for those key words. If a family is working on a word problem and they're stuck, bringing in movement, trying to act it out, mess up with it is great. But I think like two key strategies is use the simplest language you can that avoids key buzzwords or triggers. And if you can make that happen, you're going to allow your kid to begin to use language to build mathematical thinking instead of hiding it and only getting comprehension. Which reminds me, we did a video on that, so we should link that in the blog and have the families check that out.
To add to that, another strategy or whatever would be to, like, you know, strip it down. What this showed me is that math exists in this context, and we can't remove math from this context. But also, like, sometimes the details of the context, like, don't matter that much. So, like, someone is splitting things up into smaller groups. What operation is that?
Right. You know? You're saying that can even be enough. It doesn't have to.
Yeah.
It doesn't have to use language to try and like artificialize a practical scenario. Just allow it to be a scenario that I can use it. In ST Math, I'm sure parents that have tried it realize that ST Math doesn't have any language at all. It does. But early on, we typically go very visual and we create scenarios for Gigi to interact with. I would like to argue, I want to see your thoughts on this, that in a way, ST Math is a constant word problem. It gives you a scenario. It doesn't give you key buzzwords, key triggers. It doesn't just tell you the formula. You're going to have to figure it out for yourself. And especially early on, you're going to have to decide for yourself what math is even happening.
Yeah, I think that's a really good point. And that kind of echoes my thought about acting word problems out. Like, it's a whole action of math, like, happening before your eyes. And if you wanted to, you could narrate what's happening on the screen, like the obstacle in front of Gigi, and like the words you would say would pretty much be a written word problem.
Totally, totally.
And so it is the demonstration of the actions happening in a math word problem.
There's a lot more to the use of language in math class, I think, than just textbooks and lectures and word problems. Like, what are some things we could do to experience math in a story way without just being that dry lecture or textbook?
Yeah, I think it's very fixed amount of knowledge and information when really the world around us is so rich in content. And one place that I really am fascinated by is history. You know, history is the ultimate human story. We have like millennia of it. And I think something that we forget is that math has also existed for millennia. And like, for some reason in school, we've kind of like divorced like history and stories from math, when really I think they're very intertwined. And like, math has like such a pivotal role alongside human development. It's part of the human development story. If one were to research the history of math, it's so fascinating. Research the Pythagoreans, who like created the Pythagorean theorem, along with many other things, like irrational numbers. Before them, like, people didn't really know that irrational numbers existed, but they kind of like discovered them. But it was such a mind-blowing concept. It's like a whole other different type of number. It's like seeing a new color on a color spectrum or something.
Yeah.
They called them like unmentionables or like unmutterable numbers. And like, mention of an irrational number, like the existence of it, like, would result in death, which is wild to me. Cause like, now we just kind of like hand it out to middle schoolers, like, here are irrational numbers. And like, middle schoolers are just like expected to know about irrational numbers, where people were killed for that.
Yeah. It's like, it's almost like we hand math out to you out of thin air, thinking it's going to be somehow approachable and good. And like, oh yeah, it's easy if I just kind of, you know, tell you it's a thing. But no wonder kids then act as though math came out of thin air and is completely divorced from life and impractical, because you're just giving me what feels like a random fact for no reason.
Yeah.
As opposed to this story of like, here's where people were, here's what we were trying to, you know, here's what's like, zero, for example, was a very challenging concept. And yet somehow we think, you know, kids by second grade are like, it's simple.
Right. And it reminds me of another story, like when I was in college in my math classes, and like, in one lecture would be to learn this one proof. This one guy in history spent their whole life trying to discover and prove. It was someone's life work that I was supposed to learn in an hour.
Yeah, it was like a minute was worth a year. It took them 60 years and you 60 minutes.
Yeah, and really, I'm just fascinated by that mathematician's life. Like, what were they struggling with? What did they do each day while they were working on this one proof? And I think history is like littered with these examples. Like, I love to see movies starting to be made about this, like Hidden Figures or The Martian. It's these very rich, pivotal moments in history, but it's driven by people working with math. Without that math story, like, we wouldn't have, you know, space travel and sci-fi.
And it gives you the story of struggle when you watch those. They're challenging, mistakes are made, but yet we think in math class, because math is supposed to like come out of just poof, it's there, come out of thin air, kids almost feel like they can't be wrong because it was given to them as like this fact that's supposed to be automatic.
Yeah.
And I think if you allow the human story a little bit, you get to realize more, wait a second, struggle is normal. And that's good for us. And I think that's one of the really cool parts with the history. So we want to begin to offer families things that they can do, A, to help amplify those moments of learning when they are doing the word problems or the worksheets, but also activities to be extracurricular. Take a little break from the homework, the quizzes, and all of that. So one thing is, I think, research the history of something mathematically.
Yeah.
And just check it out. Just have fun with it.
Yeah.
And the other is, we're going to offer this week actual math stories that we've written specifically for families We're going to release some this week and release some next week. It's a great way to just sit down together. The kid can read it to the parent or vice versa. Pull it up digitally on whatever device you have and see how math can and stories and language can really work together in powerful ways. And without having to be or feel like a textbook, you end up creating experiences that aren't fluffy. It's actually going to create more depth than you would think. And it shows you a way that we can use language to amplify learning and our own self-identity with math. So I'm really excited to share those with people this week.
Yeah, I really love them. And I love the way that you're bringing math and storytelling together, because I think stories offer us so much. Our daily lives are lived stories, and stories are more than just words. They're actions and images and smells and what we see and emotions and all these things. And like, such a shame, like, why don't we live math that way too, especially if math is part of our very human story? And I think stories can also be really funny, you know, like, stories allow us to like go through all the emotions. And I think, you know, math can also be funny.
You know, speaking of, we should probably show people our math jokes.
Yeah.
We have some, that's a perfect for this one. So we're going to include that one in the blog. It comes apart to this conversation that when we are used to what math was when we were children, is probably what we're going to think math is supposed to be now that we're thrown into an educator role. And as every single week is that same message of hope, that we have the freedom to experience math like we're people. And I think it oftentimes feels robotic and stale. And what we're saying is this is, language is just another tool in our toolkit that allows math to be something that we as people experience like people. We're not computers.
I love that. What is so critical to the human experience? It's like stories, language, communication, and then also bringing in like math to that human equation. It's not a separate robotic thing. Math is so human.
If we can allow ourselves to experience math beyond the artificial scenarios that we try and force math into, when we allow that story of mathematics to become the story of people, and you and I now are a part of it, I think we get to experience math in a much more powerful way.
Yes, that's great. Well, thank you, Brandon.
Yeah, thanks for chatting. I'm excited for the future weeks coming up.